days ago, our Lord was crucified on the cross, died, buried. But the story didn't stop there. Hallelujah. The story is still continuing. Amen. It is very amazing that the greatest news for the world came from a cemetery. Now those who go to cemetery come back very solemn, sad, crying. But somebody came shouting, "He lives!
Amen.
He lives! He still lives!" Yes. After 2,000 years, he still, and he is present here. Amen?
Amen.
Hallelujah. And it is also a very amazing thing, an interesting thing, that all the founders of the world religion are presently lying in their graves. Buddha is in his grave. His bones are there. Muhammad is in his grave. Confucius, Jain, even Stalin, founder of communism, and you know, Stalin's body is kept in a coffin, frozen, and all the communists at least go and visit the dead body. But our Savior's tomb is empty.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Also, it is very interesting to think that Jesus is the only man. See, for example, many people we know, when they die sometimes, they come back to life for a short period. Like we know Lazarus died. After 4 days, Jesus rose, but he died late. In the similar way, there are many people in the world, by, you know, believers praying, or sometimes the doctors certifying the death before they die. So some people do come back, but Jesus is the only man who came back to life and never died. Still lives. Hallelujah. Because these are all important points for us to contrast with what we are believing against other belief systems. Now, that was not the beginning of the message. I was reading Acts chapter 1. You know, that is where, after the resurrection, what happened. Acts chapter 1, it's very amazing that every time when we read, especially this part, something new. It is true with every part of the Bible, but here was something which was very, very amazing to look at. And we might find many points in that, but today in the message I want to just highlight 3 points from Acts chapter 1, and the first part. Now I'm not going to the second part of it, the first half. Maybe you all are familiar with this part, I'm sure. One thing is that chapter 1 of Acts is a highlight of 40 days of Jesus' ministry. Jesus was among his disciples moving for 40 days, and this one chapter, at least the first 8 verses, are a summary or a highlight. Now, youngsters are familiar with highlights with the cricket. After the 2 hours match is over, it back comes the highlights. So this first 8 verses are like a summarization or highlight of what was happening in the 40 days. So, verse 3, somebody may read.
After his suffering, he showed himself to his men and gave many convincing proofs that he was alive. He appeared to them over a period of 40 days and spoke about the kingdom of God.
Praise the Lord. So, this verse shows 2 points. The first point, that he gave convincing proof that he was alive. In other words, he was telling them, "Look, I'm not a ghost. relatives there, they will start wondering whether he will come as a ghost. And in many houses, things happen. Supernatural voices, movements, all this are happening. So, it is possible that initially they would have thought, has he become a ghost? Human beings are born skeptics. Am I right? In spite of Jesus telling them, I will come back to life, I will come back to life, they didn't bother to even remember that. But his enemies had remembered, that's why they kept a watch. So, we as believers, or even unbelievers, human race is a skeptic race. So, Jesus had a tough time proving that he is alive. One difficult thing, probably in the beginning, was that, see, how they saw, how they remembered Jesus in the last scene on the cross was very, very horrific. It didn't even look like a human being. That much of battling he had suffered. So, in their memory, the battered body of Jesus was believed. And now, seeing a glorified body, they could get the contrast. They were thinking, would this be his ghost? So, proving that I am simply not a ghost, I am alive. This is what I have been telling you. And to this, he had a comfort. Thomas did not believe. Why? In spite of his own disciples telling, he didn't believe. Do we believe now? I know all of us here believe. When we say we believe he is alive, that means he is not dead. When you pray, he is dead. When you call out to his name, he is dead. Even otherwise, he is dead. Hallelujah. Lo, I am with you even to the end of the world. He is always dead. He is never away from you. He lives. He simply doesn't live in heaven. He is here as his Holy Spirit. Once I asked the Lord, why Lord, you are calling me as the Holy Spirit? Why do we have a name? Because it's easy to say Jesus and you know pray to Jesus. It is a little hard to speak to a spirit. Because we are human beings, in our imagination we should have an object to see. We should have an object. We can't imagine a spirit. So, he told me, my name is Jesus. He said, you don't have a problem. You call me by my name, but that is Jesus. Sometimes, you know, words make a big difference in our life. The old English calls Holy Ghost. Today, the meaning of the word ghost has changed. The children know only Casper the Friendly Ghost. If you tell God is Holy Ghost, they think it's creepy, it's a creepy God. So, the old English now no one translated the new Bibles as Holy Ghost. They call the Holy Spirit. That is much easier for children to understand. So, because human beings are born skeptics, they will not believe anything. Jesus had a tough time to make them believe. So, he, even though he passed through a closed door, he sat down and ate fish. A ghost cannot eat fish. Another time, he told Thomas, put your finger through my side where it was pierced. And God, in his great mercy, retained all the holes the human beings gave him. He retained all the words. Because once one person told me that one great spiritual leader of Hindu faith who died last year, he can produce Jesus. That he, when they pray with his bottle, that country where they used to worship. So this believer said, Jesus Christ cannot come out from that person's body. I won't agree. So he went there while they worship, and then, you know, after some time of their puja and worship and singing, it seems one God will appear. And the God appeared, and he looked like Jesus. But then he asked God, how can you appear here in the midst of these people? So the Lord said, look for the holes. Look for the holes. He saw there was no pierced marks. So he said, in the name of Jesus, I command you. You devil, you cannot. I bind you and you cannot deceive these people. Say you are Jesus, and you disappear. God disappeared. So, why God retained the holes made by human beings is because we know that in the resurrected body, He has all those things for us to recognize. He had all that. That is why Thomas could put his finger and clear his doubt. So much, what I'm trying to say is so much of doubt whether it is Jesus or not in his own disciples. And Jesus was okay with it. That's what I see amazing. Jesus was okay. Because Jesus already knew that these human beings are doubters. I'll show you one verse. John 16. Please read John 16, 29 to 31. Three verses.
Then Jesus' disciples said, now you are speaking clearly and without figures of speech. Now we can see that you know all things and that you do not even need to have anyone ask you questions. This makes us believe that you come from God. You believe at last, Jesus answered.
The last verse said once more.
You believe at last, Jesus.
You believe at last. I sometimes wonder, you know, so I look at this, is God, Jesus says, with what kind of tone he would have said, you believe at last? Put it like that. You believe at last? That means all this time I have been trying to tell you who I am. And at last, thank God, you believe. Because until they had believed, He is the Son of God, the heir of God, the messenger from heaven, Jesus could proceed to the next step that was going to the cross. Someone had to believe, at least His disciples. If you think of it, 3 years, so many miracles, so many sermons, so many preaching, how many people believe? Very few. His mother had believed right from the beginning, but she was quiet. It is written in the Bible, she hardly spoke. The things which were unfolding in front of her, she couldn't understand quickly, but she kept everything in her heart. But she knew this child is from God. Her husband knew. But probably Joseph had died some years before Jesus' ministry. So, Jesus did not use his mother to tell his disciples that I am born of God. He did not tell his mother, come testify to my disciples, how was I born? He didn't do that. He made them to believe by the evidence. Human beings need evidence. I read about a story in Oxford University. Oxford University is famous 300-400 years of history. In the 16th, 17th centuries, there was no problem. Everyone knew God exists and He created. But in the 19th century, people started saying that God didn't create us. Our forefathers are monkeys, apes. Thanks to Darwin. So, the church and the people, and especially the scientific community, came in disagreement with taking the fact of Bible as true. They wanted to put Bible in the mythological category. You know what is mythology? Like Indian mythology, Hindu mythology, Chinese mythology, Greek mythology. These are myths. Myths are not true. So, Oxford was in prosper. They didn't know what to do. Because all this time it was thought that Jesus was a historical person. Now, all the great scholars are saying, no, Jesus was a myth. The Bible is written, it's a mythology. So, they wanted to clear certain fact, and they contracted a man, Professor Thomas Arnold. Now, he was a great scholar and a man who had been studying many historical events and weighing the evidence and saying this history part of history was true or not. For example, now also we have so many mysterious incidents. The death of Abraham Lincoln. Why they killed him? Why that man shot him? It's still a mystery. John F. Kennedy. Why and who shot him? It is still in many. It's an all doubt, for nothing is true. And then many are. So, Professor Arnold was contacted by the faculty of Oxford, told him, resurrection. Is it true or not? Investigate. Give us the proof, then we will put in the curriculum as true. It did happen. And he was an impartial judge. Even though he was a Christian, he, when it comes to anything to study, he was impartial. He investigated, he examined all the evidence in Bible as well as outside, what all evidence are there. A very huge study he conducted. At the end, he said this. He said, I have been a man used to studying many, many historical events. But I can tell you that in all my study, I have not come across one single event as this, which by every sort of evidence is proved that 100% this account is true. Amen. Hallelujah. He said, yes, any other historical event cannot be proved as much as this can be. He said, I have not used any method which, by faith. It's not by faith. He said, what the world law systems use, I've used the same method of finding evidence. And from that system I can say, no other case can be proved beyond doubt as this. Hallelujah. So, Jesus had left enough evidence that he is alive. And in these 40 days, it was again a highlight. What we are reading, that Jesus gave convincing proof to the disciple he is alive. Are we happy about it? He lives. Sorry, it is not a fable. It's not a story. It's a historical fact. And in the same verse, we read that he spoke about the kingdom. He spoke about the kingdom. What do you think he spoke about the kingdom? Anyone want to think about it? What he would have spoke to the disciples about the kingdom? He said he gave convincing proof as well as he spoke about the kingdom. What about the kingdom? Whatever he spoke, it's not written. Whatever he spoke, the disciples understood very clearly. Because after he said all these things, whatever he said, they understood very clearly. And we can, you know, think that he said that the kingdom will be established through you people. You all are going to preach the good news and the kingdom will be established. And you have to be, you will be empowered for the task. So, one question they asked. From that question we can conclude that they understood very well. They said, Lord, when will it happen? Amen. Are we also not such people? When I see this kind of small things, you know, it gives me so much joy that, Lord, we are also like that. We just want to know when. I hope we have written the date in the Bible on this time will come. But I mean, so nice. We all will be so prepared. So, they asked him, when will it happen? Are you going to, you know, give the kingdom now? So, another thing also which we can, you know, conclude from this is that these people, these disciples, they were waiting for the kingdom. The kingdom, the glorious heavenly kingdom, God's rule on earth, and Israel be exalted above all other kings, all other countries. Now this was their hope. A theocratical society where God is king. Now they know that Jesus is Lord. He's the Son of God. Hallelujah. So he be the king of Israel and God's rule come on earth. That is the kingdom of God. Where there will be no more crying, no more pain, no more hunger, no more injustice, no more joblessness. The economy will be very good. There will be no divide between rich and poor. Hallelujah. So, they were asking him, when will the kingdom come? Now, why this question? Your interest is that today in the world there are one third of population are supposed to be Christians. A little more than one third is Islam. And then all mixed many Jews. They say more than one third is Islam because that is one very fast growing religion. Even Christianity is fast growing, but in which section of Christianity is still not very clear. So, this many people are on earth, and how many are aware that the Lord is living and He is coming? We as believers, if we are waiting for Him to come today, tomorrow, or the day after, if we are looking up to the sky, we should remember one thing, that it is good that He comes to be late. Hallelujah. So many of our loved ones has not received. God is giving time. God is giving time that we do what He told us to do. If He lives, He wants us to do His kingdom work. Living Christians, being witness is very important in the last days. So that our loved ones, our neighbors, our colleagues, our own family members may be saved. So the Lord has delayed coming because He wants heaven to be full. Hallelujah. He doesn't want us to be leaving our loved ones. Hallelujah. One interesting incident comes to my memory. Once I went to a shop and there was a boy selling, not a small shop. There were many photographs. So I asked him, whose photographs are these? All of them had the garlands. He said, this is my father, he died some years ago. This is my grandfather, he died some years ago. Then that's my grandmother who died some years ago. Then I said, then there was Jesus. He also was blind. I said, what about him? He said, that is Jesus. I said, when did he die? He said, he didn't know what to say. I said, he died, but he's alive now. Take out that photo. Don't keep it here. He's alive. If you want to keep it, keep it, but you know the garden is still alive. So sometimes, you know, small things that we see, we have to tell them he's alive. Whether he does it or not, at least tell, he's alive, you know the garland. Hallelujah. If Jesus, whatever Jesus said, this disciple understood. But today in the world, when we go and tell somebody, the kingdom of God is at hand, what is he going to understand? You tell, second coming is near. What is it? What are people outside? Those who don't know anything about Jesus. Those who don't know Bible, what are they going to understand? So today I just want to not remember or make us think about Jesus spoke, disciples understood. When we speak to the people of the world, do they understand our jargon? People call Christian jargon. Jargon means the kind of words that we use, which are very common to us. We normally, you know, it's very easy. Always we say second coming is near. Kingdom of God is at hand. The battle of Armageddon. Tribulation. Antichrist. Rapture. All these are words which we understand to some extent, but the people out in the world, they do not understand. But these things are very near. These are true. It's going to happen. How are we relating, taking this thought to ourselves? One thing I want to ask you, the youngsters here. Suddenly, you know, when we start talking about all this, are you very comfortable hearing that the world is coming to an end? I'm not asking only to the youngsters, all young at heart. All young at heart, are you comfortable? We just bought a new house. We want to live there some more years. But if suddenly the Lord comes, this nice marble and nice things we are pleased, who will enjoy? I'm just planning my career now. I want to do great things in the world as well as for God. Where, Lord, you are going to take us now? Somebody is planning your family. Lord, our children will be too small when they come. You know, I'm just sharing you human feelings, human thoughts. My two children are very young, they are in school. Sometimes my daughter will say, if God, Jesus come before the 10th board exam will be very good. Yeah? Yes, there are many here. No. We think the second coming, you know, we talk this way, the Christian jargon, we understand. But it's not so with the people outside. We want to communicate in an effective manner. We have to tell them in a way they understand. Especially the word rapture. If you tell these words, leave around this, tell, go and tell in a Catholic church or a Protestant church, they won't be very comfortable. If you preach on the 10 times, they won't be comfortable. Very often we will find words, signboards on cars, Jesus saves. If somebody sees it, they think must be a man who likes to save a lot of money, which bank he must be having that account? Or if a banker, manager sees this, I wonder, who is this person who saves? Everyone says, Jesus saves. Saves what? So people cannot understand what we are communicating sometimes. Or if you say, Jesus' blood is available for all. Give me the mobile number. To have an emergency, I can contact which blood bank. See, blood is something for us, but what is a different meaning? People out in the world, they for their understanding. Does it make sense? Hallelujah. So, we have to think that we should change some of the phrases when we talk to people outside. Coming to think of it, if people are uncomfortable, if people are uncomfortable with this fact or the truth that Jesus coming is so near, then one reason is people don't have the habit of reading Bible and studying Bible for themselves. They don't have the habit or interest to read, because when you read Bible, only Holy Spirit can work in your heart, make you understand and believe. But if you don't open the Bible, you know, it is said that Satan is very happy to see a Bible covered with dust. Unused. There is never left anything. He's very happy. So, reading Bible and understanding all is important. Last details are very important, very crucial for Christians. Most people don't have the interest, so they live in ignorance and fear. They are afraid of things, what will happen if suddenly they have to leave. They are afraid. But they are not helping that by studying. So if people are fearsome, what they should do, they should study the word. But one question I'll ask you, do we really have a good perspective of what's going to happen? Why is God doing all this kind of, you know, we read from here and there in Bible, one place is written that we all will not sleep, but we will all, those who are alive will be caught up in the air. Why God does want to do like that? What is his plan? Why tribulation has to come? Why all these things should come? What is, you know, how is it all connected? I know, we know, because it's written in the Bible, these things will happen. But how do you see a proper perspective of all these things? Why it should come? Why these things should happen? No matter however we feel about the end time, since it is written in the Bible, it will. Hallelujah. Once, when I was in the previous church, and nothing against the church. In fact, you know, when I came back in 1999 from Muscat, and I was asking the Lord, Lord, I don't want to be an idol, a person like before. I want to do something for you. Show me what I could do in this church. So, what he showed me first is, you'll be very amazed, dust and dirt in the church. I found that the mat which was in the air, one day I happened to just lift it and I saw loads of mud and dust which nobody had ever thought of clearing. So the Lord told me, start here. So, my first ministry was sweeping. I swept, I called some children, and one day we thought was enough for a few hours, so I brought some soft drinks and some chips and all for the children, and I said, you all roll out the mat, I will sweep. But it turned out that the whole church was so covered with, you know, one old lady was the one who was cleaning. She was very old, she couldn't do anything, so she used to take all, sweep up all the mud and sand and push it under the carpet. And I also know one more lady who started with sweeping by ministry. It's a dear sister who used to work in my house. When I told her go to Pastor John Joshua's church every Sunday morning, she came here, and when the service is over, she started sweeping. He said to me, Pastor, her ministry also started and God has blessed her abundantly. So, suddenly I went back to those things. that church once, one lady, one regular church going lady asked me this question on a Good Friday. She said, "I want to ask you a doubt." I said, "Yes." Was Judas a Protestant or a Catholic? Was Judas a Protestant or a Catholic? I was shocked. I was shocked to death. I said, "What?" She said, "I know he was a Protestant and Judas a Catholic. But my daughter-in-law, who's a Catholic, says no. Jesus was Catholic and Judas was Protestant." So this is one big fight in the house, and she came to hear. I said, "Madam, you are a teacher." She was a teacher. "You please read the Bible. I don't even want to tell you. Please read the Bible. You will know why they were." So we may think that people who are coming to church or going to church every Sunday and attending worship and mass, they all may be knowing everything. No. This is the kind of doubt people have. So, not understanding, not reading, not studying is a big problem among Christians. Christians all over the world. Not only in our country, all over the world. Now think about it. Instead of saying the kingdom of God is at hand, we know all the people all over the world are fed up with their governments. Whether it is democracy, autocracy, bureaucracy, whatever crazy, it is all going in one single direction, that whoever goes to the chair makes money, their term gets over, they go, and the next one goes. We all know what 60 years of democracy has done to India. People are fed up. People are fed up in Pakistan. People are fed up in Sri Lanka. People are fed up in every other country. The Chinese are also fed up. Russian, they're fed up. Americans, they're fed up. Every world over, no government has given from what they have promised. No kingdom has been successful in claiming that, okay, in our country there is no want, no lack, no tears, no injustice. Which country can say that? And as citizens, each country, everyone suffers injustice, pain, lack. So, world over, nobody is happy with the government, no matter what system they have. So, when we say the kingdom is at hand, we can say words like, the government is going to change. Hallelujah! Hallelujah! The government of the world is going to change. Hallelujah! So, when we speak to the people who have never heard or understood the gospel, we should start speaking from something they know of and then take them to the unknown. Government is something they know, but kingdom of God is something they don't know. But if we say the government of God is going to take over, invade the planet, they will start to understand. The end time events prior to the government change. Instead of saying the second coming is near, if we say before the government changes, certain things have to naturally take place. Now, if you study the histories of any major government change, for example, take Second World War, Hitler. Even though Hitler was doing one of the worst crime to humanity, the world slept from year 1939 to 1945, for 6 years, when 6 million Jews were most horribly murdered, the world did not do anything. They didn't even know, or they didn't bother. But when all the Allied forces started attacking the Axis forces, they just didn't say, okay, now we cannot win this war. Okay, people come, we will just vacate the seat. No, they didn't go. Hitler put up a great big fight. With all the powers he had, he did fight that. The same way, when the government of God comes to the earth, it is not going to be a simple matter. It has to have a big, big scenes will be enacted on the earth. So that is what we call in the last hour events or the end time events. So we have to always talk with something, you know, which people understand. The new government will have a king. So the new government and the king also will have a secret loyalist that we are. Even though we live on this world, we don't belong to this world. Before Jesus was crucified, he said, look, the king of the world is coming. He called David the king of the world. The king of the world of unbelievers. So, it is a fight between this king and that. This king will definitely garner all his forces to fight that invading king. So what can happen? How many of you know the Scarlet Pimpernel story? Scarlet Pimpernel could never be found, even though everybody was looking for him, but he was saving people all the time from the enemies. In the same way, when we read the stories of Second World War, so many Jewish people were saved by many, many people. They've all gone down in history, but without, under the nose of Hitler, so many Jewish people were also saved. Unfortunately, one went to the concentration camps. So, if a king is invading, and then this evil king knows very well that there are so many loyalists here on this earth, under my nose, supporting him, what will he do to them? He will want to do away with them all. So what will our king do? He will come like Scarlet Pimpernel. He will come in a secret mission. A secret saving mission, which we call rapture. Hallelujah. We call it rapture. What is it? It's a secret mission to save those who are loyal to him from the evil king. These things that, you know, it's like a plot. It is a plot. So many movies are made like this. After that, after his rescue plan is done, very angry king, and he hates all humankind, and all the other king's loyalists are gone. Now what he will do? He will want to have torture them. Kill all these women. After all, they are created by him. It's a relation. He will give them a hell of a time on this earth. But even God has a better plan there. He will have the best harvest. Because this king can only kill. But that king has the power to kill and even to throw them into heaven or hell. So he has the greatest harvest at the time of tribulation. So making these things very simple, which the people on the outside can understand, that we are all, like Shakespeare said, the whole world is a stage and we all are actors. We are in a plot. the angels came and asked the disciples, they were looking at the sky and standing like this, all of them. 11 of them standing and looking at the sky and continuing to look. So two men in white, the angels, came and asked, "Men of Galilee, why are you going on staring at the sky and standing here?" Same Jesus who went up, will come down. Hallelujah. He will come down. But you go and do what he said. You go and do what he said. He will come. So, in Ecclesiastes, that is the verse, 11th chapter, 4th verse, that he who watches the wind will not sow, he who looks for the cloud will not reap. What the Lord is saying, don't keep on be sky watchers, when is he going to come? So that, you know, we can say, "Lord, for 40 years I was waiting for you to come, I didn't do anything. I thought every day you are going to come." We shouldn't be like that. We should not be just watching the sky and forgetting to sow and reap. Go see, go sow and reap till the moment he comes. If you want to build a house, build a house. You want to repair your house, repair your house. You are planning to have a family, have a family. Planning to do your degree, do your degree. Doing all this, do it as the Lord wants you to do. Do all the things that we need to do in a day-to-day life. We should not be simply sitting and saying, "Lord, may I come tomorrow, why I should make this? Lord, may I come day after, but this project won't be covered." No. God wants us. The Lord wants us to keep doing what we are supposed to do. To be a witness to the world. And not be simply sitting, crossing our hands. Only thing we have to remember is, suppose he comes tonight, we should not have anything to regret that we may leave behind. Hallelujah. Anything that we may leave, we should not regret as we go on. Unused gifts, unused wealth, unused talents, unsaid words, all this we should not keep.